I'd like to introduce Michael Swanson, who is the Senior Vice President and Chief Ag Economist for Wells Fargo, the largest commercial agricultural lender in the United States. Based in Minneapolis, his responsibilities include analyzing the impact of energy on agriculture, forecasting for key agricultural commodities, such as wheat and soybeans, and corn and cotton. And the livestock sector, such as cattle, dairy, and hogs. Additionally, he helps develop credit and risk strategies for Wells Fargo's customers and performs macroeconomic and international analysis on agricultural production and agribusinesses. He provides great insight into best practices farmers should take in this economic environment to maximize profitability. I've had the pleasure of introducing him before, and I believe this is probably the fourth time he'll take the stage. He's done a great job. Please welcome Michael Swanson.
Well, thank you. Now, mic check. Can you hear me in the back there? Yeah, do you want to hear me in the back? Probably not, you know. Ag economists have a well-deserved reputation, you know. It was interesting, a few years back, I was in Clear Lake, South Dakota. Anybody ever been to Clear Lake, South Dakota? I mean, okay. It was just like this, but they had it in the Quonset hut, and it was, you know, 95 degrees and humid, didn't have any air conditioning. They started that meeting at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. I didn't speak to 8 o'clock at night. They started serving beer at 4:30 in the afternoon. Well, to say the least, it was a very, very friendly audience by the time I got on stage. And, you know, as I gave my speech, it was interesting. There was an older lady in the front row, and I gave my talk, and she got more and more agitated. Finally, she said, "Aren't you a know-it-all son of a bitch?" I said, "Mom, really?" Well, you think about it, you know, it's easy to say what people should be doing, but it's hard to make it happen. I always tell people, if I ever write a book, it will simply be titled, "Easier Said Than Done is a Great Business Strategy." So often, we know what we should be doing, but we can't bring ourselves to do it because there's something that's stopping us. There's a knowing-doing kind of gap in our lives. So what I want to talk about today is getting over that knowing and doing gap, making sure you understand that realistically, 80% or plus of your success is in your own hands. Now, it'd be great to stand up here today and say, hey, we're going to have high prices, and we're going to have low crop inputs, and you're all going to make money. And you know what? Even if that was true, which I don't think it's going to be, well, what happened is some people would make way more money than other people. And that's important to think about, because it's the relative situation that you have. So the title of this speech is Environment versus Execution. Now, you won't remember that when you get home. I have discovered over 20 years of giving speeches, people don't remember much of what you said. Typically, remember the bad jokes, you know, ones about Viagra and ethanol, busboys and Hooters and stuff like that. But when you think about it, here's what you can remember. Moneyball. Okay, show of hands. Who's seen the movie Moneyball or heard about the movie Moneyball? Okay. Okay, and I suspect there's a lot of vegans in this room, right? I don't know what it is about vegans. They're always pale, hunched over, looking miserable, right? And they don't have enough strength to raise their arms over their shoulders. But when you think about it, Moneyball was a movie about how baseball has been changed through statistics. So what does that have to do with farming and you? Well, guess what? You play Moneyball just like the baseball people do. Guess where Moneyball is in today's world? Everywhere. It's a question of understanding, are you getting the best benefit for your spending? Think about baseball managers, think about football general managers. They're out there. They got to compete with other great teams, and they have to do it on a limited budget relative to other people. So their question is always, am I getting the best player for my money? Am I drafting the best player? Am I using the best way? It's a money ball kind of world. So I'm going to start out with a statement. My different approach to economics is everything is connected. We just don't see how. We think, why in the world should I need to care about that? Well, guess what? The world's not about us. The world is going to happen anyways. It's our job as people who are executing this thing to understand it's not about us and to make this work. Now there's a corollary. If you want to go back to the slide, I want to point out the corollary in the bottom. Nothing natural moves in a straight line. I'm going to show you a whole bunch of charts here. And charts are interesting over time. But one thing that makes a real chart different than a make-believe chart is real charts don't move in straight lines. They move with all sorts of noise, all sorts of things happening. So what we need to understand is that it's our job to make it happen. Here's a no decimal point forecast. How do you know that economists have a sense of humor? We use decimal points when we forecast. There's a wink and a nod at you that we're having a little fun at your expense. We don't deserve decimal points. We can't forecast. You heard Dr. Catlett say earlier today, you know, it's not forecastable. But here is a forecast with no decimal points that I believe will come true. Yield growth globally will exceed population growth going forward, and that means that we won't be bailed out by higher prices from a shortage of food. Now, I know exactly what you're thinking because you've heard it for 10 years. Well, what about these 9+ billion people we need to feed in the future? Okay. And what about better diets around the world? Absolutely true. I'm going to show you that I believe that's the truth, but I don't believe it's going to bail you out. Because what else is going to happen in the future? We're going to be using tomorrow's technology, and we'll be using tomorrow's feed efficiencies for animals. I had the privilege to be down in Arkansas talking to a great poultry company just last week. You know, they're not done getting better. So even the best in the world are getting better. And you think about how far behind other people are, we have a long ways to go. Let's start out with corn prices. Here we have 100 years of cash corn prices. These are nominal. These mean they're not adjusted for inflation. In fact, corn prices are the longest running data series in the US government database. Go back to 1867 during the Civil War, they started collecting corn prices. Take a close look at 100 years of corn pricing. And what do you see? You see a trend. But it's not a straightforward up we go type trend. It's a big stair step function. Hopefully you've seen this slide before because it makes a big point. If nothing was more important than population growth and dietary change, we would see ever rising corn prices from the past to where we are today and would keep going in the future. We don't. What we see is every 30 years or so, we get a big jump up, lots of volatility where we don't know what's happening, and then it settles back down around the price. Without regard to where that price is, you have to perform to it. Now, what's the new price of corn? What's the new price of soybeans over the next 5-10 years in an average? I don't know. I always tell people my favorite two answers are, I don't know, and I was wrong. And Wells Fargo still employs me because they expect nothing from economists, right? It's good to have that job. But if it's not gonna be $6 for corn, what's it gonna be? I'm gonna guess $4. Okay. Take that number and just use it as a vague reference. But let's think about this. What impact does it have on you? Environment versus execution. You're playing money ball in this league. So let's look at farm income, crop revenue, and livestock revenue. It's interesting. Look from 1990 to the early 2000s. We went nowhere. We had $90 billion in crop revenue. From that $90 billion in crop revenue, farmers all over the United States, whether they're growing cotton, almonds, corn, soybeans, whatever, they had to pay for all their inputs, land, equipment, NPK, seed technology, and family living. So we had very flat revenues and very flat farm income. So what did we do to survive in that environment? We consolidated. What happened was we pushed inefficient farmers out of the business. We took on their acreage, and we used that concentration of the wealth or the income to survive. What's going to happen if we get stuck with $70 or $80 billion in net farm income and $200 billion of crop revenue going forward? We're going to do the same thing. Now, is that happy news? No, it's not. But I'll say later, I have a saying that technology respects nobody's politics and nobody's opinion. Technology changes, therefore we need to change. You have to change to stay the same. So let's think about that. What about the global situation? Now, this comes from the Food Agricultural Organization. It's part of the United Nations. They're the only people that can really collect this data on a global basis. But what we have here is the same thing we just saw from the United States. We have global agricultural revenues. That's us, that's European Union, that's Brazil, that's the Black Sea region, that's China, that's India. Report all those numbers, report them in dollars, and here's what we get. What do you notice about this chart? Once again, it doesn't move in a straight line. it's not like each year we get a little bit more revenue for farming. No, we had a very flat situation, a huge run-up, and then we flattened again. What about livestock? Same thing. Livestock and crop values typically move together for the most part. And that's an important phrase. When somebody says for the most part, it means that you better not bet the farm on it. So there's always sort of wiggles in there. But think about this. We went from $0.7 trillion in farm revenue to $2.7 trillion in farm revenue over this time horizon. That is great news for farming, not just in the United States, but everywhere. Because when your top line grows, you can do more things. Now, you're going to have to share that top line to get to the bottom line. You have certain inputs that you need to buy, whether it's land, seed technology, NPK, machinery, or crop chemical. You can't play this game unless you buy those inputs. But the good news is we're not stagnant in terms of crop revenue and livestock revenue around the world. Now, I'm going to do something. I'm going to take these very same numbers. I'm going to look at them a little differently. Now, this is something that mathematically we call doing the logarithm. Why would I do that? Well, it's because when you look at a logarithm, the change in a logarithm is a percent change. So it tells you something a little bit different than just the gross numbers. So by looking at this, let's talk about the trend line. The trend line is that straight line that we draw through all this bumping around, all these things that are happening. What do you see? You see that the trend line is much more predictable than the actual results. In fact, we have quite a bit of variation, sometimes well below, sometimes well above. But when we look at that trend, it tells us a couple of things. One is that farm agricultural crop revenue went up by 5.6 per year. That's not a bad top line growth number. Over this time horizon, it pretty much matches global GDP. Good. If you're not satisfied with a 5-6% top line growth environment, just get out of the business. Because I guarantee you there's a lot of sectors that would love to have that type of top line growth. Livestock went up at 5%. Pretty similar. Okay, what's the rule about this? The question is, what's my share and why do I get it? So we're growing, we have opportunity, we don't always grow high, we don't always grow low, but we will grow. Farming is a great long-term investment. You guys have picked a good sector to be in. Then the question is, how do you execute to make sure that you're gonna be the successful person in there? So, global trends are stable. I'm very bullish. First off, population growth. Yeah, the United States has 0.7. There's a number you should probably make in the margin because most people don't know that. We're at 0.7% population growth on 328 million Americans. That means we add over 2+ million Americans every year that we're gonna feed. Those are our far and away our best customers. The United States is the wealthiest, you know, country in the world. Therefore, we are the best consumers in the world. Adding 2 million plus consumers is a great thing. Then we have the rest of the world, that's growing at 1.1%. Now they're adding, you know, 25 to 30 million people per year. That's a great number as well. So we have plenty of new customers that we're gonna feed. The second thing we know is that GDP will grow. This is real GDP. We've had 3% real GDP growth for the last 40, 50 years. It's not gonna stop. You hear all the nightly business news about all the problems, all the challenges. Think back for a little bit. Think back to the 1970s. Think about the Gulf War. Think about oil embargoes. Think about Asian meltdowns. Think about Russia meltdowns. Any scenario that you can bring to mind has already happened, and guess what happened? Global growth absorbed the hit and kept on going. It will continue to do so. Warren Buffett always talks about worrying about the long-term trend more than worrying about the short-term issues, and it's very good advice. So we're gonna have growth. But let's dig a little deeper. Let's talk about where the growth is gonna be. Take a look, this is a time series chart. Now in a time series chart, you can see four things that can happen. One is, you have a trend, okay. Two, you can have cycles. Three, you can have seasonality. And four, you can have random noise. Now in this chart, we're only seeing two of those things. We're seeing a trend and we see cycle. But what do we notice about this trend? It's declining. We have 1.1% population growth, that's good. It used to be 2%. Now they're projecting that it's gonna be 0.5 in the future. Why does that matter to people in this room? Because agriculture changes just like population growth changes. There is nothing constant out there. So if agricultural growth exceeds 1.1%, what happens to the market situation globally? we get more product per person. Can we do that? The answer is most definitely we can do that. What about production? Well, we've had lots of change. We're going to have lots of more change. This is grain and oil seeds. This is total global production of grains, total global production of oil seeds. And then I take the natural logarithm once again so I can talk about the trend. What do we see here? We've had about 1.9% increase in grain annually since 1960s. Now, not every year, you get wiggles, you have issues, but we've had 1.9% growth in the grain market since 1960. During the same time period, we've grown population at 1.5%. Okay, I know you're a smart audience. You know that 1.9% production growth is a bigger number than 1.5% population growth. That means we have more grain today per person than we've ever had before in the history of this time series. Probably more than the history ever of humanity. So we have more grain. So why do you think people are going to give you more money for something when the supply is growing faster than the demand? What about oil seeds? Different. About 4% growth in oil seeds over the same time horizon. Why is it different for oil seeds? Because they're fixing a different problem. They're fixing the protein problem. We grow oil seeds, whether it's canola or soybeans or palm. We're growing it so we can feed it primarily to animals so they will grow faster. Talk about poultry rations, hog rations. They all depend upon a high protein diet. We started that 30, 40 years ago. The rest of the world's just adopting that. Why in the world does China buy all those soybeans? They don't want to eat soybeans. They want to eat meat. And this meat has allowed them to modernize their animal practices. They can't step back from soybean, because if they step back from soybeans, they don't have the type of grow out that they have today. They don't have turns, they don't have the velocity. They'd have to have a huge herd of pigs without the soybean meal. So we've had a lot more soybean growth than grain growth because it's solving a different problem. But going forward, what do you think? If we continue to grow grain and soybeans and oil seeds at the same rate, we're going to have more supply per person than ever before. We can certainly use it. There are plenty of people in the world who are underserved when it comes to food. The question you have then is, do they have the right amount of money to pay you? Now, quick show of hands. Whoever had a Slinky as a kid? Anybody ever have a Slinky as a kid? Okay, they're great toys, right? They don't depend upon batteries. But you must have asked yourself the Zen-like question at one point as a young child is, why does a Slinky bounce? No, you didn't, right? Kids play with Slinkies, they don't think about them. But think about a Slinky. Why does a Slinky bounce, and why does it matter to me as a producer? Think about this. If you take that Slinky and hold it in your hands like this and let go, well, the Slinky falls down, but guess what it does? It bounces back up, falls down, bounces back up. It keeps bouncing for quite a while. Why? Because it's the nature of the Slinky. The way it's coiled means that the energy goes out but comes back in. Contrast that, though, with a piece of rope. Next time you have a piece of rope, hold in your hands like this, just like that Slinky, and let go. What happens? That rope unravels, but does it bounce right back up? No, because all that energy was dispersed out into wherever. It's called entropy. Slinkies bounce because it's the nature. Why does that matter to you in this room? It's because agricultural markets bounce because it's their nature. They have feedback loops. They look at each other. Anything that has feedback loops will bounce. It will inherently be not a straight line. You need to know that so that you don't get freaked out about it. You know, I love sports philosophers. One of my favorite sports philosophers is Wayne Gretzky. Show of hands, who's ever heard of Wayne Gretzky? All-time leading scorer in hockey, right? Then you probably know Wayne's quote, right? He said, he's asked, how do you score so many goals? And he said, most people skate to where the puck is. I skate to where the puck is going to be. Wayne was talking about that inherent sense of anticipation, that games playing, the ability to see the game being played. Amazing. Who's my other favorite sports philosopher? Dr. Michael Tyson. Remember Dr. Tyson, the boxer, right? Big face tattoo, you really gotta wanna live with that statement. But what was his comment? Somebody asked him, well, what's your philosophy? He said, most people had a plan until I punched them in the face, right? Now think about that as a farmer. You're gonna anticipate, and guess who Dr. Tyson is? The market. You gotta be ready for this. Let's talk about bounce. And let's talk about being ready for it. Things are balanced, and they don't always stay in balance, but they go back towards balance and overshoot. Let's look at the last 20 plus years of soybean and corn prices. Every month, I simply took the price of soybeans in the United States divided by the price of corn in the United States. What do you see there? Going back to that idea, trend versus cycle. Is there a trend here? There is no trend. We have the same 2.5 ratio between the price of soybeans and corn. But is it ever 2.5? No. It goes above it, then it falls below it, then it goes back above it, and it falls below it. It cycles, just like that slinky bounces. Why? Because the market's always chasing that balance, but never gets there. What's another source for us to deal with? How about the global price? Once again, it's not just about us. What we have here is U.S. soybean pricing in New Orleans, ready to go out into the global market, versus Brazilian soybean prices in their ports, ready to go out to the global market. What do you notice for all the talk about tariffs, exchange rates? When you look at the price of soybeans in these two different ports, in the price of dollars per metric ton, it's the same market. This is what we call the law of one price. I used to work as a grain trader for Cargill in South America. Nobody really cares where their grain comes from. They only care about the price and deliver to them at their home market and their currency. So we live in this slinky world where we need to be able to understand it's going to bounce and we have to deal with it. So let's step back and think about the business of growing corn, the business of growing soybeans. Here's some questions I think you should ask yourself. One is, what is corn worth? Seriously. When you sit down, don't ask yourself, what do I think corn price is going to be? Don't ask yourself, what would I like it to be? But say to yourself, what is corn worth? And then you should answer, why is corn worth that? I had the opportunity to be up in Muscatine, Iowa last week, talking to a group of producers also there. And I said, look, think about this. The group I was visiting with was at a meeting for Kent Feeds. Why do you think they buy your corn? Why do you think the ethanol plant buys your corn? Why do you think the barge company buys your corn? They want to make money on it. It's as simple as that. When somebody buys corn and soybeans from you, it's because they think they can make more money by paying you that price they just gave you for the corn and soybeans. Is that wrong of them? No, because if somebody didn't think they could make money buying your corn and soybeans from you, they wouldn't buy them. And then you really have a problem. Now we're digging a little bit deeper. Talked about this earlier. Who gets what share? You cannot expect to grow high-yielding crops without high-yielding inputs. And the people that supply those high-yielding inputs know what they're worth, and they want their share. Here's the money ball question. Did they get more than they deserved or less than they deserved? And how do you know that? That's the money ball question. Wins above replacement. It's one of those phrases you hear in cybermetrics. Talks about how valuable a player is at their position versus another player being at that position. When you're working with Wiffle, you should be asking yourself, and they should be telling you, why they're wins above replacement, why they're a better seed for the dollar than their competitor. When a supplier can supply that type of information, give you the concrete information, explain it without any malarkey between you and them, that's a great relationship. But you need to ask that question. You shouldn't be thinking, I just wish they had cheaper seed. Why? They know what the seed is worth. They know what's going to contribute. They work hard. They deserve to have a share as well. The question is, it the right share? What else? What differentiates you? What makes producers different? I'm going to show you very clearly from a number of different data sources that not all farmers do equally well at any point in time. But what makes them different? What is it that the good producers do versus the poor producers? And once you've decided on these questions, what are you going to do about it? It's great to hear this stuff, but what are you going to do about it? So, here's that bumper sticker I talked about. Technology respects nobody's politics and nobody's opinion. I don't care if you don't want it to happen. If there is a change in technology, you simply have to deal with it. You know, and I just celebrated 140 years on the family farm with my cousins. It's a long time. Fifth generation, I see the sixth generation coming. And they didn't like this slide very much when I was talking to them. On the left-hand side, you know, somebody says, well, they tried something different and they failed. And the other guy says, well, they're a bunch of idiots, right? Well, on the right-hand side, they did the same old thing as they always did and they failed. And the other guy says, well, what can you say? What's the key thing here? They both failed. Whether it's failure because you do something that's radically different or failure because you don't do anything, they're both failure. So we need to think about that. Farm technology isn't about farming. It comes from someplace outside of farming. Farming is a great part of the economy. You know, we produce about $400 billion of livestock and crop revenue. That's out of $20 trillion. That's 20,000 billion, okay? So we're a big piece, but we're certainly not the biggest piece. This technology being created outside of agriculture, it comes into ag tech, and then it impacts farming, and then farming impacts ag tech. This is what we call a feedback loop. It's a contractionary loop. It means farming will shrink because we can. Whether you like it, dislike it, you should understand it's not about us. Can we see this? Sure. Let's take a look. Let's look at the green line first. The green line is planting corn and soybeans from 1980 to 1984. What do we see? According to the Census of Agriculture done during that time, there were 715,000 farmers, corn and soybean farmers, in the United States. They planted 142 million acres on average during that period of time. Guess what? See how long it took them to plant it? See the slope of the curve? That's how many times, that's how long it took them. Fast forward to 2012 to 2016. According to that survey, there's only 349,000 farmers. We've shrunk the farming base in half. But now we're planting 170 million acres of corn and soybeans, and we're planting them even faster. We're seeing how steep that curve is in the middle. Why? Because we can. We all know as farmers that there are optimal windows to plant and optimal windows to harvest. And what you want to do is hit the window because it's a big yield penalty to be outside the window. What else on the harvest side? Same thing. Same numbers, same consolidation. In fact, it's even more obvious that we harvest ever faster than the day. A couple of implications. First is basis and pricing. Because we plant faster, we have less risk spread out. We can put crop in when we need to. And we harvest faster, we have less risk again. When there's not a risk in the market, you don't get a risk premium. There's only two emotions in farming, right? Fear and greed, right? And I don't think that's true. I think people are fearfully greedy all the time. But when you think about it, anything that takes risk out of the market for the economy also takes out premium. You can't market your way out of this problem. I'll be very, very sincere. You know, you can fail on marketing, but you can't out-compete on marketing. Think about what that would mean. If you knew the market so well that you could always outperform everybody else in terms of selling your crop, why even grow the crop? It's the oldest saw in agriculture. If you're that smart about it, just own the paper. Why worry about the dirt? So you can't out-market this problem, but you can outproduce it. Let's look at a data source. I'm going to look at the Minnesota Farm Management Database. It's called FinBin. If you want to write that down, F-I-N-B-I-N, FinBin. Just Google it someday. It's the longest running public database out there. They typically have between 2,000 and 2,500 producers in this database on an annual basis. What do we have here? We have the bottom 40% in terms of financial returns versus the top 40%. The top is going to be the low-cost producers, and the high costs are going to be the bottom. What do you notice about the two lines? They all sell their corn for the same price. They move up together, they move down together, and there's not a very big gap between them. Let's look at the cost differential per bushel on them. This is very interesting. You dig into that data, and you see that the bottom 40% in terms of cost versus the top 40% in terms of cost, there's typically a dollar plus differential in Minnesota on cash rent ground. Now, we're talking cash rent ground, so we don't have to worry about when it was bought and what you're paying to yourself. Wow. A dollar per bushel gap year in and year out between good producer and bad producer. And people say, well, how does it happen? Well, I guarantee you, it's pretty straightforward. A, they're good at buying their inputs. They buy them just a little bit cheaper, and that's everything. NPK, seed, equipment, you know, those things. And then they're better operators. They get better yield in the same environment. Good yield, bad yield, they get a little bit more yield because they're more timely, they're a little bit more consistent, they've learned a little bit more than before. It has a big impact. So I believe when you look at the numbers, cost of production dominates marketing. And if that's true, what should you put your money on? Where should you put your concentration? Go where the money is. Anybody ever hear of, there was a famous bank robbery, Willie Sutton. Anybody ever hear of Willie Sutton? He got caught, okay? And he said, well, Willie, why do you rob banks? And he looked at the guy and said, because that's where the money is, right? You need to be Willie Sutton when it comes to your plan. You gotta rob where the money is. And the money's in the production, not in the marketing. So think about that. Moneyball. A week from now, hopefully, if they had, what do you remember about that talk? It'll be the title, Moneyball. You only get paid for what you bring to the game. If you're not bringing seed technology to the game, don't expect to get paid on it. If you're not mining the NPK or making the fertilizer out of the air, don't expect to get paid on it. If you're not supplying the land, don't expect to get paid on it. What you want to get paid for is what you brought that was unique and useful to the situation. Now, vertical integration, opportunities and risk. Crop production. People in this room are primarily crop production. And there's a couple of issues right now in crop production. Land's overpriced. I'm going to talk about that at the end here. And crop inputs are controlled by some pretty big sellers. What about livestock? Livestock's not a free ride either. You got lots of issues, labor and automation, you have siting and permitting, which are difficult, but they have a little advantage. There's more suppliers of technology, and there's a little bit higher value added on a labor basis. So let's talk about where do you want to go and what can you do? Return on assets. Sincerely, who's heard of return on assets? Show of hands. Who really understands return on assets, right? Some of you do, good. What is return on assets? It's pretty simple. You take your profits during a period of time and you divide it by the total dollars of assets that you needed to deploy to make that money. It's a ratio, it's a percentage. Why do we need to talk about that? Because I'm going to prove to you in another way there's a big gap between high performer and low performer. Are your assets working hard for you? There's also something called return. You have yield enhancing assets, whether that's land, irrigation, tiling. You have cost reducing assets, things that take out labor, things like that. But let's look at profitability or return on assets. This comes from the Risk Management Association. This is crop producers. Now, not just corn, but it has almonds, cotton, strawberries. All crop producers that are in the database are in here. So it's not just corn in Illinois. But I want to make the point. Let's look at these 800 plus producers each year and look at the gap between average, poor, and great. In the middle there, we have about a 4.7, or let's make it 5% return on assets. That means for every $1 million of assets that you deploy in farming for crop production, you should expect $50,000 of profit. Okay? Not bad. So if you deploy $10 million, you should get $500,000 in profit on average. Now that's an average. But look at the poor performers, the 25th percentile, weak. They get zero. They deploy that same $10 million in assets, what do they get? Zilch, nada. But let's look at the top performers. They're running along at 12 to 14%. They deploy $10 million in assets, they get $1.4 million in profit per year. Wow. Think about what the impact's gonna be in terms of consolidation. If you're average, $500,000 on 10 million, yeah, that's not bad, you can live on that. That's a good, good situation to be in. But you're fighting with people that are earning $1.4 million. And they're always eyeing the assets of the guy that's making no money. How does that happen? Let's look at sales to dollars. Another thing you want to talk about is, do you have lazy assets? Let's look at sales ratio to dollars of assets deployed. This is a ratio. So once again, let's look at those same producers. On average, if you have $1 million of agricultural assets and crop production, you produce $1.5 million in sales. That's pretty good. But look at the top performer, 2.5. So he has $1 million of assets, he's gonna produce $2.5 million in assets or sales. And then the bottom performer, $600,000 on that same million. What makes that big difference? You think it's not real? These numbers come to us from a huge variety of different lending institutions. We don't make up these numbers. Why would we make up these numbers? But it tells us that it is possibly very, very different in agriculture, from great to poor. Let's look at another point that should resonate with you. There's a real jerk out there, his name is Jeff Bezos. Who's ever heard of Jeff Bezos? Okay, he's the CEO owner of Amazon, right? Huge seller. And why is he a jerk? Because he says stuff like this, your profit is my opportunity. What does he mean by that? Any money that you're making, he wants to come take it off your plate and expand into your business. Guess what? Why would he say that? Let's look at the amount that we see paid from agriculture to owners, directors, and officers of ag companies. Once again, big gap. On average, 3% of gross sales goes to owners, directors, and officers of farming operations. Okay, so $1 million in sales, $30,000 in payments to labor. Now, the very aggressive ones, the best performers, are doing it for about 1%. But look at the weak performers, 6%. So they're giving themselves $60,000 on that same $1 million of sales. Guess what Jeff Bezos is going to think? I'm going to buy them out, take their 6% contribution to their family living expenses, and plow it right back into the business. That's how he plays the game. That's why Amazon is huge, because they play that nasty game of saying, hey, if you're inefficient, I'm coming after you. Agriculture does the same thing. It might not have a name like Bezos behind it, but when you're a weak producer, you're not getting returns, you're not turning your assets, you're paying yourself too much, you become the target for everybody else in the market, unless you have a plan to get better. So, Moneyball, you're the general manager. You should stop thinking of yourself as a player. You want the technology to work for you. You want your assets to work for you. You're the one out there, you're the field marshal. You're making things, directing them. You're not doing them. 40 years ago, farming was about burning diesel and raising dust, right? If you got up earlier, worked later, you made more money. Not today. Farming is a smarts game. It's a game of knowing who are the right players at the right price. And this is nothing new. Like I said, 1878 was when my great-grandfather Peter founded the farm out there in western Minnesota. This data starts in 1910. That was when my grandfather John was running the farm. Let's look at the ratio. How much of farming revenue for crops has gone to these inputs? So what inputs are we talking about? Seed, electricity, NPK, fertilizer, soil conditioners, pesticides, fuel, and oils. Way back in 1910, 1920, about 10% or less of crop revenue got spent on these categories. Look at today, 2018, the current estimate, close to 45% of crop revenue is gonna go into these elements. Why? Because you can't raise high-yielding crops, and that's a must, to compete unless you buy these inputs. It's getting more important to be a money ball manager because that's where the money is. Another chart from the USDA, this one they put together. Here they have three things, capital, labor, and then purchased inputs. Purchased inputs are things that you buy from somebody else. And what do you see here? You can see that labor on a real basis is adjusted for inflation has become a very small part of agriculture, crucial, but small, whereas the purchased inputs from a third party keep going up and up and up. I'm not making this stuff up, but I guarantee you, if you're gonna forecast, these are only gonna get more important as you go forward. They're gonna get bigger and bigger. You need to decide today to be the best money ball manager that you can, and you need to say, how am I gonna make it happen? So what have I said so far? Big gap in farming performance. We showed you that. It's real. When people talk about the farmer, I wonder what they're talking about, because I've never met the farmer. I've met hundreds of thousands of farmers, but I've not met the farmer. Marketing, I don't believe is a competitive advantage. You can fail on it. How would you fail as a marketer? By doing it all at once or doing nothing, right? If you sell all your crop on one day of the year, wow, you might hit a home run or you might completely strike out. That's like having a stock portfolio of one stock. If I gave you $1 million, would you buy just one stock? No matter how hot you thought the tip was? No, you wouldn't. You would buy different stocks. You'd have some winners, some average, and some losers. But on average, you would be pretty good. So where do we compete? It's production cost. You get paid by the bushel, not by the acre. There's a bumper sticker that I tell farmers all the time. Landlords are paid by the acre, farmers are paid by the bushel. If you don't remember that, you're not in the game. Big difference in production cost. So let's not let the dollars blind us. What do you hear this time of year from people? Sometimes you hear, well, my banker won't let me spend any more money. Well, then fire your banker and get a better one, right? Because what you need to do is manage your crop all the way to the end and then beyond. But don't let the dollars blind you to the real trade. What do I mean by that? Moneyball. Are you paying the right number to get the right trade out? I'm gonna go back to that Minnesota Farm Management Database. How do you compare 1994 to 2016? If you look at cost of production per acre, radically different. This is what I did. I took the average cost of production for those 2,400 producers, and I divided that cost per acre by the different categories by the price of corn. Why? Because if I spend $40 per acre and corn's worth $2, these are easy numbers, 40 divided by 2, I can say I spent $40 per acre, or legitimately I can say I spent 20 bushels per acre. because 20 bushels and $40 is the same thing. Now, by saying it's 20 bushels per acre, I can compare it to the yield in that year and say, what percentage of my yield went to that input? Here are the big five: land, equipment, NPK, seed technology, and crop chemical. What do you notice here? The technology is not stagnant and nothing is constant. First off, you're sitting here at Whipple Seeds. Let's look at the seed crop chemical relationship. Back in the early 90s, it was 10% and 10%. 10% of your yield went to seed technology, 10% of it went to crop chemical. What happened as we put more GMO traits into the field? We saw that we substituted away from crop chemical, but the seed technology wasn't stupid. They knew that you were saving money on crop chemical, and they were willing and able to raise the price on the seed. Now, you have to ask, is that still true? Technology, weed pressure, all those things are up for reevaluation every single year. Let's look at things like land rent. In Minnesota, over the last 16 plus years, about 28 to 33% of the land, of the yield goes to the landlord. They need it. They deserve it. You can't say, no, you can't get it. The question that you need to have is, am I overpaying on a yield basis, not whether I'm overpaying on a dollar basis? What about soybeans? Similar numbers. Once again, seed technology displaced crop chemical. You need to sit down with every single one of your input suppliers and your landlords and understand before they do, what's the right trade? And if they don't come to the right trade, you have to understand, who can I go to get a better trade? So, summarize these. I know these are in your handout thing. I want to make sure that you guys get a chance to see those. But they're very different. Soybeans versus corn. I call them the big six here with crop insurance. About 80% of your yield will go to these concepts. You can't avoid it. What you can ask yourself is, can I get a little bit better at each one? Let's say on average, seeds 11% over this time horizon. If you got it done for 9%, that makes you a superstar. You're not gonna get it done for 6% or 7%, just won't work that way. But if you got it done for 14%, you were losing money and you just didn't even know it. You look at these things and say to yourself, I cannot give away more than 100% of the yield and expect to be in business. You need to get this done for 80% or less on an ongoing basis. So how do you make that happen? You heard Dr. Gloy talk earlier about farmland. I'm gonna touch on that as well. Here's another bumper sticker that I have. I always share it. Farm the best, forget the rest. Why? Because however you define farm ground in your market, great farm ground is typically high price and poor farm ground is priced too close to it. What do you see? The same seed, the same NPK, the same equipment, the same labor on bad ground in your market will not yield like good ground. It's the same inputs. It's not the inputs problem, it's the land's problem. But what's the problem that we have? Every landlord thinks that their ground is perfect. Show of hands, who's found that true? That their landlord thinks that every piece of ground they have is just ideal. Just this slice of Eden, right? But it's not, and you know that. But if they don't know that and you can't convince them, you have to fire them. Oh my goodness, I know that's blasphemy because you don't want to fire a landlord. But I always say every farming operation is two in one. You have the farming piece and you have the land management piece. Most people don't rent it all or own it all. There's always a mixture. And you got to be very, very careful about what we call transfer pricing. What is transfer pricing? When you have a large corporation that has multiple things, they often sell and buy from one another, different subdivisions, things like that. They have to establish an arm's length transaction to make sure that they don't overpay for what they produce. So you think about that. Are you overpaying yourself for your farm ground and then over cross-subsidizing a neighbor? Do you know that? Have you sat down? Do you know the numbers? Moneyball again. So let's talk about why I think the land market's overpriced still. Well, how do you compare prices over a long time? You normalize them. Just like I took the yield for corn and soybeans and what percent goes to what inputs, I want to normalize land prices. How do I compare 1930 to 2017? There's a world of difference between those two periods of time. But we can compare them. You normalize your prices. You normalize your yield, and then you look at a historical trade. Just like trading corn for soybeans, corn for seed, corn for NPK, you trade corn for land, you trade soybean for land. So let's look at the historical trade. From 1930 to 2017, I have long-running data in southwestern Minnesota. It's a NAS district, National Agricultural Statistical Service district. So I went back, grabbed the data from my friend at the University of Minnesota, and I said, how many years of yield did I trade at any point in time to get this piece of transaction on average? Well, you got the Great Depression on the beginning of the chart there, and then we have World War II up to the 1960s, and then look at some of the volatility we've had. If you look at how many years of future production that you're trading over the last 3 years, it's been record high. Drop back down to 10, but we've been over 10 for the last 4 years. That means that you're giving the current seller, on average in that district, 10 years of future production just to get that. Historically, we thought 6 years was reasonable. 10, how is 10 reasonable? It's not. No matter how much it's dropped, on this basis, it's still unreasonable. Now, I've had this discussion many times in many places. What I've all heard from all farmers is the land market is always overpriced. What have you always told me? I've never bought a piece of ground that cash flowed when I bought it. Show of hands, who said that to a banker? Who said that to somebody else? I've never bought a piece of ground that cash flowed when I bought it. Yep, you've all heard that. And it's true. Land is never a deal. It's always overpriced. But guess what? It can be more or less overpriced. That's a different statement. I'll give you that land's always overpriced, but is it more or less overpriced? And how do we know that? Let's look at cash flow versus the average price of ground in that district. Let's go back to 2000. The red line there is the average sales price for ground in southwestern Minnesota. It's good ground, not as good as here, but it's good ground. Last year, right around $7,000 an acre. Cash flowability was $3,500 per acre. Wow, 2x. So when you look at this chart, it looks like the land's gotten even more expensive. Not true. When you look at the ratio between cash flow and price, it goes from ridiculous to average, ridiculous, back to average, back to ridiculous. We're still at ridiculous. We're paying over 200% of cash flowability on that ground today. That's way too much. If you wanna make money in farming today, it's not being a buyer. You know, we heard Dr. Gloy say he bought that ground. There's transactions and there's a different things. Let's talk about that. I don't mean to say universally that land's a bad deal. That's never true. Let's look at that district another way. Every single one of these dots on this chart represents a sales transaction from last year. What do we have up here? Left to right, we have the quality rating, the CER in Minnesota, and then top to bottom, we have the price per acre for that transaction. What do you notice? Only about 40% of the quality of the ground was explained by the price, or the price only explained 40% of the quality of ground. That means that 60% of the price of ground is something other than its quality. I want to point out two transactions. There's one transaction there, way down on the bottom there by 70, where it's about $2,000 an acre. I called my banker in the area and said, explain that transaction to me. He said, oh, don't worry about that. That was mom and dad selling it to their son. Well, I said, okay, I get that. And I said, well, look at the top of that chart. There's a 70 transaction that went for $12,000 an acre. Explain that transaction to me. He said, oh, don't worry about that one either. It was a sister selling it to the brother. So you know what I'm talking about there, right? And I've been told the secret to success in farming is being born an only child, so I don't know about that one. But what we see is there's a lack of discipline in this market, and it's everywhere we go. Everywhere you turn, there's a huge lack of discipline. Let's take Purdue's numbers. What do we see here? Just like Dr. Gloy said earlier, I'm gonna use Purdue. This is basically a 3,000 acre operator in Indiana. What Purdue does every year is they survey cash rents in Indiana. They have six geographies. They have average, great, and poor ground. Then they put together this crop budget for corn on soybeans on a 3,000 acre operator. The numbers are what they are. But here's the point. Look at the yield on the top line there, and then look at the cash rent on the bottom. What I'm saying to you is that the gap is not big enough. Why? Because this is a landlord approach to farming. This is dollars per acre. You don't want to talk about dollars per acre, you want to talk about dollars per bushel. So let's do this. Let's take that yield on the top and divide it down through all those columns and see what it is per bushel. Now we see a very different picture. That 136 bushel yield ground that you got for cheap rent is not cheap. It's really expensive. Even though you're only paying $1.11 per bushel, and the guy on the top ground is paying $1.21 per bushel, look at how he beats you every single which way on the seed inputs, on the NPK, on the equipment, on the labor. Low yielding ground is at 486 break even. Mediocre ground is 438, and high-yielding ground is 4 under this budget. Wow. So which ground do you want to farm? And don't tell me you want to farm at all, because that's the wrong answer. And I understand that it's really easy to accept bad to get the good, but does it help you? Did you do the numbers? Did you take a trade? Think about, go back to sports again. When they trade a superstar for 4 or 5 other people, they got to evaluate it all together, not just one. Look at it another way. Let's look at that yield, the black bar. Look at the variable cost, the cash rent. Then look at the machinery. Look at the family owning, living expense. Look at the bottom yielding ground there. That 136 bushels of ground at $3 a bushel doesn't even cover your variable inputs. Why would you farm that piece of ground? I mean, if you did nothing, you're better off just paying the cash rent and being done with it. You'd lose less money that way. Average basically gets to break even. Only the great ground at a 350 pricing gets anywhere near giving you a real contribution back on your living expenses. It doesn't make any sense just to farm because you can. Moneyball is about discipline as much as anything else. So, what did I say? I'm gonna wrap it up here. You get paid by the bushel. If everything you do is about producing bushels at the right price, you're doing the right thing. But if you get stuck on P&Ls that are about acres and grosses, you're not looking at it the right way. And your average is your success. And how do you change your average? Have you ever heard of something called addition through subtraction? Well, what it is that when you take out a weak piece, you get better. So why are you gonna do something that's gonna drag down your average? You need to look out there and very carefully say, what equipment do I need to change? What do I need to change so I can take out my weakest performers? If you can't make them better through irrigation, through tiling, through some fundamental change, if they're just not gonna respond, you need to fire those assets and maybe not even replace them. But why would you drag down your average by having a weaker performer? What are you gonna do? Moneyball. Once again, moneyball, moneyball. You're gonna adopt and adapt. You're gonna adopt somebody's technology, you're gonna adapt something from them, and then you're gonna adapt it. You're gonna change it just so it's unique to yourself. You need to be your own technology change operator. You need to think about, what do I need to be different 1 year from now, 5 years from now, 10 years from now? If you're not making changes every single year, you get faced with these huge changes later on that you maybe can't adopt to. And lastly, asset discipline. Easier said than done. I know that. I'm up here talking about what you need to do. I'm just like a medical doctor, right? I don't like my doctor. He always tells me I gotta do more exercise and eat less. Hell, anybody can tell me that, right? I want a pill, you know, right? You want something easy. Somebody give you a pill, great health. There are no pills out there. There's no pills for your health, and there's no pills for your financial health. You need to know what you need to change, and you need to make it happen sooner rather than later. Well, with that, any questions, thoughts, or comments? We got time for that? Well, if not, then let's turn it back over. Oh, right. Thank you very much.